So my name is Elizabeth East. I am one of the directors here at LA Louver, and happy to welcome you all this sunny morning to a conversation about Kitaj. Kitaj's art and influence, and we have four distinguished guests who I will introduce in just a moment. First of all, I wanted to say a little bit about this exhibition. We are showing here a selection of paintings and drawings from 1992 up until 2007, which is the year that Kitaj died. This follows on, actually, from a long association that we've had with Kitaj, beginning in the late 70s. In 1979, we included his work in the exhibition, This Knot of Life. And in 1988, we included him in This British Picture. But it wasn't until 2003 that we actually had a solo show of his work, and it was his first solo gallery show here in Los Angeles after he had moved here in 1997. So the work you're seeing here is actually work that he completed during his final years in London, and the majority is of work that he made here in Los Angeles. It includes work from the period that we showed 10 years ago, but it also includes work he made in the last 2 years of his life. Kitaj is an artist who is both heralded and has been reviled for his work, most famously in 1994 in London, when he had a major retrospective at the Tate, which caused a great deal of critical discussion, some of it quite vicious and personal, some of it positive, but it created quite a furore. The show traveled here to LACMA and also to the Metropolitan and didn't receive quite the level of vitriolic discussion. But what occurred in London actually provoked Kitaj to leave the UK after 40 years. He is an American, or was an American, of course, but he is associated very closely with the School of London and is often spoken of in conjunction with David Hockney, who was his peer at the Royal College, Frank Auerbach, and Leon Kossoff, whom we also represent. So to today, a couple of things. One is that in addition to this conversation, we will be hosting another conversation on Monday, October 28th. Paul Holdengraber, who was a cultural force here in Los Angeles in the early 90s, will be flying from New York, where he's the head of the Live from New York Public Library Program, to instigate — he's not moderating, he's instigating — a conversation between Tracy Bartley, who was Kitaj's assistant during the last decade of his life and is now the director of the Kitaj Studio, and who is in the audience tonight, I'm happy to say, or rather this morning. It's been a long day already. And also Derek Boscher, who was a peer of Kitaj's at the Royal College and currently working as an artist in Los Angeles. And David Myers, who is the chair of the history department at UCLA, who has written recently on Kitaj and most notably for the catalog for the Obsessions retrospective that is currently traveling in Europe. Okay, so onward to today. We have four wonderful distinguished guests. I will start to my immediate right with Joe Biel. Joe Biel received his MFA from the University of Michigan. He is currently on faculty at Cal State Fullerton. He is represented by gallery, I say Kukai in Berlin, where he will be having a show next year. He is currently in the midst of his grand opus, a mural scale work that features over 1,100 depictions of television sets. It was written about in the Los Angeles Times by Leah Ullman. And he will also be having a solo show closer to home, opening December 21st at the Sweeney Gallery in Riverside. So welcome, Joe. To the right, Tom Wudl, who we have worked with for many decades. Recently, we held a very successful show of his recent work. Tom has been with LA Louver since about 1980. He has exhibited worldwide. Notably, in 1972, he was part of Documenta, the famous Documenta curated by Harold Seizman. He's also shown at SF MoMA, the Whitney, in Japan, and across the United States. Thank you, Tom, for participating this evening. This morning. To Tom's right is Rebecca Campbell, also an artist represented by L.A. Louver. Rebecca was born and raised in Salt Lake City. She received her MFA in 2001 from UCLA, and in fact, L.A. Louver has represented her since that time. Rebecca has shown throughout the United States, also in Europe, in Spain, and in Switzerland. She was the subject of the exhibition Seeing is Believing, curated by Sarah Cochran at the Phoenix Art Museum a couple of years ago. And she is the recent recipient of the Eben Demarest Award for her project called The Potato Eaters. And then our moderator this morning is Tom Knechtel. Tom is represented by Mark Selwyn Fine Art here in Los Angeles. He has, as with our other distinguished guests, shown very widely, including Sintra Portugal, SF MoMA, The Hammer, and numerous others. And I will yield the floor to Tom to begin the conversation. We anticipate that it will probably last about an hour or so, and there will be questions at the end, so I hope no one's in a rush. And of course, before you leave, if you haven't already done so, we provide validation if you manage to get one of the coveted spots in the garage across the street. Thank you all.
Thank you. Can you hear me okay? Okay. I thought, by way of preamble to my first question to my fellow panelists, I would tell a little story about my own first encounter with Kitaj's work and with Kitaj himself. When I was about 20, I went away to CalArts in 1972, and I knew nothing about contemporary art. I had no understanding of the contemporary art world, no contact with it. And you can imagine it was a little bit of a baffling experience. And I spent a lot of time in the CalArts library, sitting in the stacks, pulling out catalogs and looking at books to see if I could sort of get my bearings. And there was this one catalog I pulled out that had a photo of the artist, has the picture facing the title page. And it was this incredibly sexy man with this curly hair and this wolfish grin and these crinkling eyes, and I thought, ooh, I want that. And in fact, last night I went through a file I kept of stuff relating to Kitaj, and I found the picture. I had Xeroxed it and pinned it over my desk like it was beefcake. It's faded, it has the pinhole in it still. And I think Kitaj probably would have loved the idea of a young artist entering his work via the libidinous route, actually. And it gave me an entrance into work that allowed me to find my own path into figuring out how literature and history and sexuality could be integrated into figurative art. And then years later, when Kitaj moved to LA, my husband Bob Baruch and I went to meet Kitaj a couple times on his Thursdays that he had. And the first time we went, and the door was opened by this tiny gray man who was not like... And I was kind of stunned, even though I knew, of course, he was older. And he was so sweet, and he was so generous. He had catalogs for us that were signed. He was incredible. And when we left, as we're walking down the street, Bob turns to me and he says in a slightly reproving voice, "You're acting like you're drunk." And what had happened was my crush was completely re-inflamed. I was completely head over heels again. And so with that as sort of a way in, Rebecca, let's start with you. What was your first introduction to Kitaj's work, and if you met him, to Kitaj himself?
I never met him, so I don't have that perspective. And the first time I saw the work in person was here at Louver, the last show in 2003. When was it? 2003. And I was sort of fresh out of graduate school. I had just finished at UCLA. And my epiphany during that show, I felt, I often actually snuck into the library in graduate school to look at painters I felt I wasn't allowed to look at. And put those stacks in the corners of my studio, put those books in places that, you know, I'd only bring out at certain times. And when I walked into the show, I had this sort of almost like rush of naughtiness. Like, they're showing this in public because the critical conversation surrounding painting, or at the time, anti-painting, had seemed so much of a fortress and so much of a particular perspective that I really naively didn't know how big the conversation was. And I was grateful to the show, because I felt all of a sudden that the sort of the tenets that I had been told were rules were just simply there to be broken, and he had been breaking them for years and years and years. So for me, it was kind of a tacit thrill.
Mm-hmm. Now, Tom, I'm sure your contact with Kitaj was not on the same libidinous route mine was, but I know that you knew him much more than I did.
Never be so sure about everything.
That's true. So, but you knew Kitaj better.
But I must say that, you know, from a male libido, I've certainly been impressed with his ability to eroticize the feminine, you know, in a very stimulating way. Now, you see, I went to school probably before you were born or shortly thereafter. So my first contact with Kitaj's work was when I was in school, and those were the days of pop art and minimalism and process art. And although I didn't see any actual artworks at that time, I did see reproductions in magazines. And they struck me as being peculiar in a way, because I didn't know anything at the time, but I instinctively just felt, well, these are odd pop art paintings, because clearly, and now in retrospect, we see that that wasn't his intention as an artist at all, but being a person of his time, he couldn't help but use the visual vernacular of the period. Subsequently, I read an interview with Kitaj in a magazine that was some years later, and I don't know when, and I was rather turned off by it, frankly. And then when I saw other pictures, I thought of them as being rather superficial. And at the time of the retrospective, that was the famous Tate retrospective, which then came to the LA Museum, I just want to preface this. I don't want to monopolize, but I just want to say this. At that time, I was going through a transition in my work. I'd been painting these very elaborate oil paintings because I'd worked very hard to teach myself how to paint like Flemish artists. And the thing that I loved doing eventually became a tyranny and stifling. And I felt that it was stifling my creativity. And I was in a crisis. I didn't know. I knew that I was a narrative artist whose work had autobiographical suggestions, and yet the way I had been painting up until then was no longer viable. And I didn't know how to break out of that. And all of us artists have been through these transitions from time to time, and we know that they can be, you know, they can precipitate a very serious crisis. So around that time is when this Kitaj retrospective arrived at the County Museum, and my friend, then Nancy Hirsch, now Nancy Cantwell, said she had tickets for the opening. And whoever she was going to go was with busy, and she invited me to accompany her. And I said to her, well, we better go get a drink first, because I think I'm just going to have to tolerate my way through this. You know, I had a very, very negative predisposition.
Recently in another talk, I called Tom the grouchiest artist I know.
Well,
I love it, but he's grouchy.
Well, I'm happy you've had an opportunity to restate that. I wasn't present at that talk, but I did see it on YouTube.
Okay, so what happened at the LACMA show for you?
So, gee, I don't know. Now I'm confused.
Okay.
About that grouchy thing.
Well, what was okay?
I was ready. So we went and had a couple of drinks, and we were ready to go into the show. And right away, I realized what all of us have an opportunity to understand: how wrong the impressions were that I'd formulated about this artist, and I can say without exaggeration that I returned to that exhibition at least once, if not two or three times a week during the duration of that show, because it was so important. I also want to emphasize that I wasn't so impressed with the later work. It was the early and middle period work that I wanted to really study and digest, because this was it. Here was the answer. This is what I'd been looking for. Here was an artist who I felt had similar kind of intellectual interests, and whose work, you know, we had similar interests, it turned out, but he had invented a way of being able to be narrative, but at the same time, pay attention to something that's always been important to me, which is, I'm using this word advisedly, but it is only the most appropriate word, virtuosity. So attention to crafting an image in a very specific way that was a complete way of representing everything, both the intellect as well as, you know, fulfilling the pictorial necessities.
Tom, I want to come back to the late work in another question, but I wanted to get Joe here. So, Joe, what was your first encounter with
You know, it's funny. I had actually forgotten that when I was an undergraduate, I went to a small, you know, private college in Des Moines, Iowa, called Drake University, and I studied with this guy named Jules Kirschenbaum, who was a pretty idiosyncratic, very representational. He wasn't at all like Kitaj in terms of his style, but he was in the sense that he was really interested in literature, he was really interested in dealing with tradition, and also being irreverent about tradition. And he literally pulled me aside, I think when I was about 18 or 19, in a painting class and said, you need to look at this guy. And it wasn't because he loved his work, it was because, in fact, he was ambivalent about his work in certain ways. But in particular, the way he fragmented things, but yet had a very strong sense of rendering and form, and a sort of, as he put it, he went toward beauty, but he also was quite suspicious of it. And I remember, I really remember my teacher actually talking to these things very specifically about, to me, about these things. And I'm not sure I could understand them completely at the time, but it kind of went into my deeper self. and bounced around. And then I also happened to, just by incredible coincidence, be in London for that 94 retrospective. And I remember having the experience of, it's kind of the feeling when you hear a piece of music that's so strange to you that you think you might not like it, but it marks you.
Yeah.
And I think that's sort of how I would talk about it.
I think that's the wonderful thing about encountering Kitaj when you're young, is that you feel like you're way over your head, and yet it's incredibly exciting.
Well, one of the things that really hit me was the strangeness of the content and the pictures, and the disjunctiveness of it, but yet the incredible skill and traditional, almost classical way of composing, that would the structure that would hold it together, and that impressed me.
Well, let me ask you about another thing that you brought up, because you talked about how this teacher talked about the relationship of literature to work. And I think, you know, part of what goes on in all four of us is we're all artists who in one way or another are involved with literature or history or ideas somehow being embodied by the work. So for you, how do you view that in Kitaj now as as an older artist? How do you view that?
Well, you know, the thing is that for me, I think one of the conversations I've had with him in my mind over the years, I never met him either, unfortunately, but I sort of felt like, I've always felt like there was some shared sensibility in the sense of that kind of literary, you know, sourcing. And it sort of seems like something that's often out of the ambit of a particular kind of hip art world. But for me, it's always remained really constant. And I guess the thing is, it's the idea of standing apart from the past, in a way. Like, his stuff seems really contemporary, but yet it's infused with things from that tradition. And somehow they can coexist, and it's something that I've always aspired to in my own work.
Well, it's an incredibly, I've always viewed, part of what keeps Kitaj's work from collapsing for me towards illustration is that it's incredibly self-contradictory. You talked about this person saying that the work is very ambiguous. I mean, the work is constantly sort of throwing things at you that you don't quite know how to digest them. I mean, Rebecca, for you, how do you come at that aspect of Kitaj, the aspect of, you know, literature, history, or sexuality, other things being crammed into the work?
I would say that it's multiplicitous. I don't necessarily see it as being contradictory in that I see it as having the ability to hold multiple truths at the same time.
Right.
So for me, that's one of the strengths of the kinds of painting that I like, is that it has a poetic sensibility about it. And I mean that in terms of this sort of meat of the work is much more about presenting a tone than a sort of conviction or an answer or a particular idea. So it may in some ways look as if it's contradicting itself, but it's simply presenting a sort of either an emotional tone or a historic fact or a reference to something, and it reinterprets them. An illustration for me is something that's trying to get a particular point across, and these paintings are much more sophisticated than that. They are wrestling with an idea in public, is what I see.
That's actually a wonderful way to describe it, that there's this kind of thing in process in front of you. I mean, Tom, how do you come at that in Kitaj?
Well, I have to say that what I zero in on is the quality of painting itself, which is part of this poetry and part of this multiplicity that you're talking about. I have a rather jaundiced view of all the exegeses, to use one of his own words, and I find it so annoying that I don't even want to deal with it, but I love the paint and the painting. And before, you know, as a way of preparing for today, I was sitting at the dining room table, and we have an earlier painting of mine that's from that period when this transition occurred. And I was sitting there, you know, talking about this difficulty I have with Kitaj to Melanie, but while I was speaking to her, I was looking at the painting and I thought to myself, well, there's a lot of Kitaj in that painting. But the Kitaj that's in that painting is not the exegetical Kitaj, but the virtuoso Kitaj, who, in my opinion, was able to communicate the essential, essence of art just with the paint and the line, and the rest of the stuff, you know, just gets in the way as far as I'm concerned.
Well, so talk a little bit about then, what was that like when you met Kitaj and you became friends
with
him?
Well, that's something else. I was so impressed with that show that I did something that I never dreamt I would ever do, and I certainly haven't done since, which is that I sat down one night and I wrote him a short note. And I had heard about the death of his wife, so I understood that it was none of my business, but somehow I couldn't ignore it. It was almost like a condolence note from somebody whose business it wasn't at all, saying essentially that, you know, it's too bad you find yourself in this situation, but you should know that there are people out there in the world who you may never even meet, to whom your art means a great deal.
You know, hold that thought. You know, what's fascinating about hearing you say that is the way that I connected with Kitaj was when that thing happened in London, where he was torn apart by the critics, I wrote him a letter also, and I said, I hope you, because he said he was never going to show his art. He was so furious and wounded at that point. He said he wasn't going to withdraw from showing. And I wrote him a note and I said, I hope you realize there are lots of us who have had an ongoing conversation with you for years. And we really want to keep that conversation going. I didn't say, and by the way, I had your picture pinned over my desk. but he wrote back two lovely postcards. And so it's interesting to hear you say that you were on the same track.
Yeah, about 6 months later, I received a very sweet postcard for him as well. Well, the way I met him was this. At that time, I was still doing time at Art Center occasionally.
Oh, now.
Oh, I forgot.
Yeah. I teach there.
So sorry.
Part of the fun of a conversation with Tom is the gentle flick of once in a while.
What was that word? Grumpy? At that time, Richard Hurst was in charge of the graduate department there, and I occasionally was paired with graduate students who might be interested in having me look at their work. And Richard had known about how important this retrospective had been to me, and he had invited Kitaj to come speak at Art Center, and Kitaj had said that he didn't really want to talk about himself, it was going to be a different kind of presentation, and so Richard asked me if a week before Kitaj's appearance, if I would give a introductory kind of talk about him. So I sat down one night writing this thing down and I felt it was just so dishonest that the things that I knew about Kitaj were just not, you know, I didn't know very much about him as it turns out when I sat down to put this thing together. So I screwed up all my courage and called him. And he did answer the phone, and as you said, he was very nice and acquiesced, and I went and visited him. And the other part, and I'll just make this really short, what was important about this particular meeting, during this crisis, of imagery, etc., for me, I felt really alone, and that, you know, I was perhaps, I couldn't do, I probably wasn't getting the message across of how I wanted it as an artist, and the, because people didn't seem to me to be getting it. And I thought, you know, I was really questioning myself to a certain extent, and meeting with Kitaj was validating for me. So he gave me that. I realized after I left that afternoon, we had spoken for a couple of hours, and we spoke about topics that were important to both of us, literary as well as painting topics. And I realized, you know, no, I understand that, and this was, you know, really validating, and it reassured me and allowed me to move forward. So he gave me a tremendous gift in that mm-hmm. regard.
So let's tackle something that you alluded to, which I think is a real interesting issue. All four of us are artists whose work employs a kind of draftsmanship and technique that one associates with sort of an older tradition of art. And all four of us use that as a means of kind of conveying content or embodying things. And yet part of what happens in this late work that we're surrounded by of Kitaj's is work that is done by an artist who Kitaj himself spoke very openly about the idea of an old age style. And he talked about how Cézanne reached the same point where you reach the point where you jettison what you know of technique to move to a more radical simplicity. And so we can see Kitaj doing that in this work. And I'm curious about how we all deal with that as artists who are different, who have a different relationship in that regard to what we're doing with our work. And Joe, how do you tackle that?
Sure, it's something I've been thinking a lot about, particularly since I saw the show. You know, I actually don't think I would use the word jettison, though, I have to say.
Rephrase it then.
No, it's just in my mind. To me, it's almost like sublimating virtuosity into like an essential quality. And it takes an amazing amount of skill, I think, to do that. Because it's non-ego-based, but you have the confidence to almost not think and just, you whatever mark goes down has a sort of rightness. It really reminds me of other artists and composers like late Beethoven quartets or late Rembrandt, you know, or late Matisse. Actually, this show makes me think strangely of Bob Dylan's album, Time Out of Mind, where it's not about cleverness and the guy is incredibly clever, but it just goes past that point, so it really cuts through to something incredibly direct, and it's very moving, but not in a maudlin way, even though he's dealing with potentially maudlin subject matter.
Do you find in your own work that you have moments that you, I don't want to say jettison, but,
well,
you move aside. You move aside the ego in the way that you're talking about and make a more direct relationship.
I think I'm trying to move toward that, but I have not, first of all, I don't think I've reached the mastery point, so I'm not sure I can have the second part yet. But I also don't think that, I think it's something that simply happens. So I think I'm not there yet, but it's something I suppose I'm aware of that right. potential, and hopefully, well, I don't know. I don't even know what to say about it in terms of my own practice. But
Rebecca, what relationship do you have to this work and that issue?
Well, I guess for me, brevity is an incredibly important skill. And there's a Manet painting at the Norton Simon, that one in the very back, the beggar with the little still life down at the bottom. And I remember staring and staring at the still life at the bottom, and it seemed kind of almost mean-spiritedly severe sometimes, because it was so economical. And then I had this moment of like, can you believe he did that? And then I saw an even more severe Manet in Chicago of a seascape in which I felt I had that sort of really pedestrian sort of, I can't believe he got away with that. They're hanging that. And I spent so much time surrounded by other amazing paintings, and I was having this sort of, like I was sort of being flogged into watching this painting unfold in its just severity. And then I realized it was something I desired very much for my own work. I also saw it in a big painting in Laura Owen's her show at MoCA many years ago, and it was a painting of these sort of orbs, and it just pissed me off when I saw it. I was really enraged and had this complete transition until it was my aha moment with that show, in which I thought, this really is a brilliant move. And I haven't exactly been able to unpack that mixed relationship, but I think in terms of your specific, the way you've started asking this question, in terms of Kitaj, I have a mixed relationship with that economy and with the evolution of the work. And I have had periods where I am more sort of finished. I don't know if it's hard to talk around this concept because the words sort of escape. But I think we were talking a little bit before the talk started that there are things that happen to artists in life that are beyond their control or sort of seem beyond their control. I mentioned, you know, Basquiat was a drug addict. There are people who are, you know, Chuck Close is physically wrecked. There are things that happen to artists that then affect their work. And I think it's not very valuable to look at it in terms of value. Is it a good thing? Is it a bad thing? It simply evolves the work in a particular direction. And age has had an effect on many artists. And one of the effects has been brevity, economy, essentialism, all of those things. And so I look at it as part of the breadth of how we can make pictures. And to me, it has incredible value. And to compare the late work to the early work is, they do completely different things.
They do.
So for me, they just function differently. Just like the work from the 60s, there are clunkers and there's genius. Mm-hmm. And to me, that's the same with the late work. Those paintings in the back room on the right side, the snake and the boy.
Oh, the snake there's and the like, boy is beautiful.
And there's like four, five marks in the boy painting,
right.
And it's brilliant. It's David Park, it's got that ch-ch, just a sort of incredible confidence and economy, and yet it's still able to say something deeply resonant to us.
I have the same response to this green painting that's behind us, which I love, because in that painting there's all these different languages going on, mm-hmm. You know, the stain, this kind of smear, and the way that that green figure is sort of hovering over the figure of the woman is really exquisite. But as you're saying, I mean, I remember when I saw the retrospective, it was a baffling experience to approach those last rooms for me. Because there were some pictures that were really set my teeth on edge, and other pictures, I remember like the Bad Back, Bad Eyes paintings I really loved, and that seemed to me about the kind of economy we're talking about. So Tom, I mean, you said for you, the late work is not the work that you related to when you went through the show every time. Right. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Let's see.
I love the coyness of saying to Tom, can you talk about that?
I will try.
I promise I'll stop teasing you.
That's fine. It's about time somebody did it.
Well, let's make it specific. Is there a painting in this room that you feel works for you, and another one that you really feel typifies what you're having a problem with?
Well, just excuse me, I'm trying to formulate this thought because I want to say something without just rambling on and on. So, you know, when we look at the Manet and we see this crazy thing happening that we can appreciate, we also know that is to a certain extent inconclusive because this artist and the artist of his generation and the subsequent generations were instinctively moving towards a territory that they could only apprehend by instinct because the language had not been developed yet. And the example I'm always using in this case would be Matisse's painting, The Blue Nude Memory of Briska, which is a great painting, but that's a qualified greatness because it's really a very uncomfortable and in many ways an ugly painting. And I believe it's that way because Cubism, Matisse had not gotten ahead of Cubism yet, and he did not have the language. He was still trying to use archaic language of figuration and illusionism to say something that was outside the venue, outside the vocabulary of illusionism and traditional figuration.
So how do you tie okay, that to
Kitaj? I'm getting there.
And the train will pull into the station eventually.
All right. But you get the point. Right, that's how my preamble to this thing. And it took, you know, right now I'm reading the catalog for that show that was at the Museum of Modern Art a while ago, the radical invention
that's
or something,
incredible.
You know.
That's
okay.
Incredible.
And what that meant, when you read that book, the authors there are also tapping into this and saying, you know, it took a long time for the vocabulary, not only the verbal vocabulary, but the pictorial vocabulary to be developed, for a transformation to take place. And during this transition, many awkward pictures were painted by many artists until this thing was established. And that's, you know, just for the audience here, that's the nature of the challenge of creativity, to be able to come to terms with what is initially an instinctive drive until it becomes codified in a particular way that's understandable, and then something can be built on it. My feeling about these late paintings is that Kitaj would have had to have made some very, very essential decisions and departures from the archaisms that he was so immured in his whole life in order for these abbreviations to really be effective and be meaningful and dynamic. I think these are transitory paintings in that regard. So I'm not doubting their sincerity, although that can be parsed too, but because I doubt, you know, when I was really pissing and moaning to Mel about this thing, I said, you know, just the very idea of a late style is such an old-fashioned idea. I mean, somebody should have taken him out and spanked him for saying something like that. It's ludicrous. There isn't such a thing. Those artists that he identified himself with arrived at that pictorial representation out of discovery, out of trying to work out through certain problems that had established themselves in their painting, not because they were cleverly trying to design a late vehicle for themselves. And that's something that, you know,
hold
is
on,
problematic.
Rebecca.
So anyway, okay, I'll hand it over to you.
I have this idea, well, I've had this experience with my own work that I feel like, so we have different projects, different tangents, different paths that we travel as painters. And I feel like, you know, your head starts cooking something up and your body is not in on it at first because your body's working on this project over here when your head starts to wander. So your head's cooking this thing up and finally it convinces the body to follow. And then the body says, all right, so we're going to work on this new idea. And the body is in the dark and the brain's pretty much in the dark too. So you end up with these mostly ugly, very strange paintings in which the brain and the body are trying to articulate something that is over there. And then there's this sort of second phase in which the brain's more clear about it
and the body has a few chops, which I feel like these are sort of in that realm where the brain is starting to configure a new idea and the body is almost on board. Then you get this later stage in which the idea, the brain, is fully articulate and the body is gung-ho. And those pictures, in some ways, to me, are beautiful, but not quite as interesting, because as the body and the brain have clarified, they've edited. They've gotten rid of a lot of the sort of poetic question marks that accompany these images, in which you are left thinking, what the? Yeah. Which is an excitement for a painter. Yeah. And then the last stage, to me, is usually the stage in which the you get the most accolades, in which the body has completely taken over and can make these pictures that has taken, internalized the idea, and it is making images that are amazing to be in the presence of, and the brain is gone. The brain has already moved on to the next phase.
I love that way of describing it. I think that's a great way to describe it.
You know, that's a beautiful and eloquent statement, but I fail to see how it's applicable here.
This is how I think it's applicable here, which is that for me, we have the luxury as makers of things to not really have to talk about one particular object or another, because it's a sort of a process of living in the life of art. And this is part of his, is sort of that journey. And I feel that some of these paintings are closer to one phase than the, I mean, some of these are pure economical genius. There is a sort of brevity and confidence and clarity where you can see the future of this body of work had he had 20 more years
to
paint.
So we're in agreement that this phase is incomplete.
No, but I actually do hear
what you're saying, Tom, but I actually see more links between the past work, and I think Kitaj seems by definition to be inconsistent in his, it's sort of his MO. But I don't know the title of it, the yellow painting with the blue figure. I mean, that seems totally in keeping with work from the 80s. I mean, to me, one of the links is a sort of ugly beauty thing that he seems to be really interested in. I mean, he was a real literary guy. You know, Baudelaire talks about contemporary idea of beauty has to hold the grotesque within it. And I feel like fairly early in his development, he moved toward that. He always messes, interrupts.
Well, and in fact, that I remember that part of the difficulty I had starting in the 80s, and then when I saw the retrospective with the later work, was that I really was seduced by that incredibly opulent, beautiful work from the 60s and 70s.
Me too, yeah.
I mean, they are so beautifully made. And they work within a very recognizable tradition of beauty. And then I felt, in a way that I trusted with the artist, even if I couldn't understand it, he had moved the ball into another playing field. And I had to try and follow him to keep up with the work in the 80s, where it got more clotted and strange. And then with the simplification that happened in the later work.
But you know, even in, I'm thinking of a painting called, was it, I think it's the Jewish school. It's got all these
figures. Oh yes,
it really reminds me of
the golem. They're drawing.
That's
the golem.
Right, and that painting reminds me of it. But he really just will not let the composition balance, and the scale shifts are completely irrational. And I kind of feel like he felt he needed the element of poison. I mean, what's interesting in this show is there's a, the lyricism is totally naked, and then the ugliness or the bizarreness is totally naked, and they're not mixed together in such a sophisticated cocktail, but I actually really feel like he's the same artist in some ways, as much as it's different.
I feel like that some of that, what you're speaking to, is actually what makes this relevant now, too, because it has become so much more obvious, those two sides of the work. And I have another question about the kind of the sort of nakedness of the idea itself, because it seems like the earlier work was more coded and more mixed and more subtle. And here you get women who are completely anonymous and
symbolic, allegorical objects put in the paintings. And then you get these sort of portraits of real human beings with hair, you know? And I think that's pretty interesting. And I think he also has this sort of historic tenet, and then he has this sort of almost ridiculous sentimentality to him. Yeah. So I think those things are very, are stripped down in the work, and it makes it sort of very fresh in a way that he seems unapologetic and unmitigated about these sometimes contradictory impulses.
Well, and the other thing that happens in the late work that's interesting is that he puts himself in the work so insistently. He has this story he's telling himself, and he puts himself into the work over and over and over again. Go ahead.
I mean, he reminds me of King Lear at the end of his... He's like, fuck it, man, I don't care anymore. I mean, I mean, in a way, his work is anti-literary toward the end in that way, in terms of consciousness of literature, maybe, but... Right. He's become the tragic hero in the play, except he's painting the pictures. I mean, it's kind of reflexive.
Right. It's not larded with as many historical references to modernism and
although, you know, I think that's a Michelangelo drawing, the crucifix. And so he really goes, he'll quote directly without irony. That's another thing I find amazing about him.
Yeah, which is very uncomfortable and also fresh.
He's not a good soldier as a postmodernist.
He doesn't
fall in line.
But there is a sort of defense mechanism to quoting as well. You know what I mean? There's sort of a costume that you wear to be, you know, I think the more brave paintings are actually the paintings where he's like melting into the woman. And those very autobiography is the big, dirtiest word you could possibly bring up today. And he's unabashedly just wallowing in it. And those to me are the greatest strengths of the work.
Have you seen, I saw a clip of him in his studio talking about the Cézanne bather paintings. I don't know if anybody's seen that. And I mean, it's a very moving clip of him. This is my image in my head is he's clinging to these three late Cézanne bather paintings like a lifeline. Right. And he feels like he's barely holding on, even in that. And it's interesting that takes quotation to the point of what quotation becomes autobiography, which is kind of bizarre.
And in fact, I remember the second time Bob and I went to meet with him, he had one room of his house that was lined with Cézanne etchings. All the etchings Cézanne had done were in one room together.
Well, he when you go in there, he was very, you know, part of the tour was, well, this is my Jewish library. This is my Cézanne library. And, you know, I think this is a tricky thing for an artist. That kind of identification that you're talking about.
Tricky how?
I think it's walking a tightrope, and it's a double-edged sword. And I think this because of my visits to Kitaj and our discussions. You're right, he was hanging on to those things like a lifeline, and this is where I have a problem here. The double-edged sword is that you identify so completely with this that then you don't have an image anymore. You lose yourself because it's so important to you to be part of this brotherhood of superstars of art history, both painters and intellectuals, right? He completely, you know, that catalog that exhibit at the Berlin Museum is entitled Obsessions. Well, you know, that is there's a intense narcissism that I'm not saying that that's a bad thing, but it can backfire on you.
It can.
Rebecca just said the narcissism is a prerequisite for being an artist, Tom.
So. I guess I feel that this is something we're all guilty of. And to me, there's absolutely no question that Kitaj has marked every one of those images, that they've been through the digestive process and come out Kitaj, you know? And there may be, people need to riff on different things. I don't understand why Toymans constantly riffs on the other, but some of the paintings are remarkable because of it. We all have a particular process, and I think to fault the process when the painting is an interesting object in the end is...
Well, that's where you and I would disagreement, would have a disagreement, because I think it leads to not such an interesting painting in the end.
Oh, well, then that's a
You know, that's the right. essence of our disagreement here.
But I, you know, it's interesting, but for me, it's actually his, sometimes, I mean, some of the paintings I think are amazing and they're brilliant and beautiful, but I almost think I have admired Kitaj over the years for his stance more than for his work, which I realize presents potential hypocrisy or at least paradox, you know, but his ability, his willingness to walk the line and to perhaps risk 20 failed paintings to get the brilliant one. I sort of admire the anti-production line mentality.
Though there was this very interesting thing with Kitaj, because you know my relationship with Kitaj early on was through the catalogs, not through, I didn't see real work for years.
Right.
And I would get the catalogs from Marlborough every time they came out. And for instance, there's this one painting, I think it's called The Jew, that's a man sitting on a train.
Yeah.
And it would be reproduced.
The Jew, etc. Pardon? The Jew, etc.
Yeah, and it's reproduced in several catalogs because he would keep working on it. He wouldn't let go of it. And there were other paintings like that that they would keep turning up again, over and over again. So there was this also this kind of anti-production mode of I'm going to keep hanging on to this. The other thing that I don't quite know how to phrase this as a question, but it's something that seems to be sort of between the lines of what we're saying, is Kitaj's investment in the idea of the outsider. Kitaj is very interested in people who are gay, in Jews, in people who are exiles. He himself was an expatriate, you know. And so, I mean, it seems to me that also is another role that Kitaj kind of plays in the work and is part of his narrative that he has going, is the idea of the outsider.
I don't know if this speaks directly to it, but I think it's related to it, this idea of him wanting to make a Jewish art.
Right, yeah.
And
Did you read the Diasporous Manifesto?
I didn't read the whole
thing. It's really hard to read.
Yeah.
It's really difficult.
I love him for this.
Yeah.
And yet it's an entirely broken idea that I'm also involved in.
Okay.
Because I find that I'm often thinking things like that about making art as a woman. And yet you put that premise out there and it's broken because it's essentialism. What is it to be a Jew? Well, it is everything and nothing and specific things and ubiquity. It's the same as a woman, that you're making something that seems very specifically and uniquely processed through a particular perspective that has some sort of boundary that can never be drawn.
Right,
you know,
right, right.
So I think that's very interesting, and I appreciate the sort of desire to articulate the thing that can never be defined, right? It's like Barthes, the sort of the punctum, the thing in which it's always over here. Kitaj talks about Warburg a lot, which I think is interesting, and if you think about his library, the way I understand it, is that you go to the catalog, you find the book that you want, you go to the shelf, and the book you're actually supposed to have is two books to the right.
Right, right.
Which I think is essentially what we're doing. But the risk in that, and what has I think is being erased by sort of a lot of postmodern thinking, is that we're not supposed to have that desire at all anymore, that we're supposed to sort of see the ridiculousness of not being able to define or come to some essential truth, and so we should give up the pursuit to this sort of completely relational painting, which is how I feel about Cecily Brown's show that was just up at Gagosian, that there is this overall sort of ambient cynicism to most of contemporary painting, especially of the figure, that Kitaj is like, no, not interested. Just because I'm going to be wrong with my, you can, any kind of opinion you set forth, there are going to be smarter people who can prove you wrong. And I think that that is not a reason not to have opinions. And I think Kitaj had very strong opinions and painted from a position of declarative painting. He was saying something with the work.
I would agree. You know, I was thinking about David Foster Wallace, the writer, wrote an amazing essay about television and American fiction, but at the end he talks about the next group of literary rebels being sincere. That would be the most, that would be the most, you know, forward, radical stance. And he talks about single entendre principles, and I mean, what Rebecca just said, I would say, Kitaj is willing to take an emotional stand. He's willing to sort of be sentimental. For me, I think that's what I sort of meant when I said, his stance is what's important to me. I mean, to me, he fits into, you know, painters like Gustin, who definitely deal with contemporary content, but who do it in a sort of, Gustin couldn't be in the postmodern canon because he was melancholy, or Francis Bacon, you know, fits that to me, you know. Yeah. So.
And I think there are a bunch of young Turks who are taking it up, simply bored with this sort of ubiquity, and that. Actually, Heather turned me on to a couple of young German painters, Katie Heck. You know, you could think of Neil Rausch. There are people who are like, I'm going to tell a story. It's going to be a confusing, long-winded, strange, abstracted, with no moral at the end or conflicting moral, but I'm still going to tell the story. And I think that is, you know, it's a classic idea. There was a performance artist who came and spoke at UCLA while I was going to school there, in which they went through this long story about the travel through performance, and they ended up coming back to the Black Box Theater and talking about this amazing epiphany of how amazing a stage and an audience is. And to me, you know, that is the artist's tragic flaw, is trying to articulate and realize the thing that you will chase forever. You're going to chase it forever, but it is simply the pursuit that is important. Just try to tell the story.
Why don't we open it up for questions? Yes, right in front here.
I believe I'm the only one here who ever had Ron Kitaj as my teacher.
Wow.
When I was, so I'll just tell the story rather briefly, but when I was 19 years old and studying at UCLA, I saw in the catalog that figure drawing was being taught by Ron Kitaj. And you had to show something that you did to be accepted. And by some fluke of good fortune, the drawing I brought in was of Sandy Koufax. Ron Kitaj, among all other things, loved baseball and Jews. We became fast friends. Okay, now, I don't mean to disappoint you, but to me, the greatest appeal of Kitaj was his rampant heterosexuality. When I knew him, he was the closest thing to Richard Burton I had ever seen in person. He had just come from England, he sort of had a British accent, he dressed Carnaby Street, and every girl wanted to be near Kitaj. Now, by some fluke, he decided to accept me into his gang. And he would invite some of his friends to our figure drawing class, which was always beautiful women. And they would draw naked, beautiful women, and then we would go to their houses for lunch. I don't know why he included me in his group, but they were some of the most wonderful conversations I ever had in my life. Now, there was a life lesson that I learned from Ron Kitaj. And I will pass it along for those of you unfortunate enough not to have been in our drawing class. His technique was, twice a week you would come in for 4 hours and you would draw with a pencil the exact same pose. The model would come back the next week, pencil drawing the exact same pose, the same piece of paper. We had now worked 16 hours on one pencil drawing. I lost my mind. I went to him and I said, I do 5-10 drawings a night. How can I sit here for 16 hours? How many pencil marks can you make? And he said to me, and this was the life lesson, he said, first of all, you have to know how to draw. You have to know how to go in. You have to know how to look. You have to know how your hand, you have to train your hand to do what you're seeing. You have to do it. Come to school every day, draw in pencil the same drawing, but I'll look at anything that you paint. Bring it in, we'll talk. How wonderful is that? Now, I would bring in my things that were whatever they were. And he would, and I would say to him, you know, I'm this impatient embryo. You know, I want to do this, and I want to go make films, and I want to be a photographer, and I want to be a painter, and I want to... And he sat me down, and this was the lesson. He said, he started me out with, you have to have a life first before you can be an artist. Maybe you have to do what I did and join the merchant marine and sail around the world and have a hooker in Havana and then move to England. And he, for an hour, he told me his whole life story, how when he grew up in Cleveland, he wanted to play for the Cleveland Indians. Next, I'm in a brothel in Havana, I'm in Paris, I'm at school where Hockney is the kid sitting next to him his first day. And then at the end he said, and then a few years ago, my agent gets a call from Sports Illustrated. Will I go down to Florida and draw the baseball players? And he said, I lived my entire life for that moment. He said, if you're supposed to be an artist, it's gonna happen. There is nothing you can do to stop it. It might take 40 years, it might take 50 years, but if it's supposed to happen, like my drawing baseball players, it's gonna happen. And that I kept with me. Now, as luck would have it, and thanks to Tracy, I got one of those Thursday afternoons when he was an old man. So as a young man, being with Kitaj was like being with this cross between Richard Burton and Bob Dylan. Complete literary references, artistic references, this handsome, energetic guy. Now I go to the house with my offering, because you always bring presents, and Susie and I had gone to France, and I brought him back stones from Mount Saint-Victoire. And I said, I couldn't afford to buy you the Cézanne painting, but I brought you Cézanne's mountain. And he let me in to talk. Okay. Now it's a different conversation. You're in the room with Moses. He has a white beard down to here. And the conversation is now philosophy, a lot about philosophers. Yes, he had the Jewish library, and he had the Cézanne shrine. And at each place, you would go into this deep philosophical talk. Yes, I would try to get him to talk about Van Gogh. He loved Van Gogh. We would talk about Picasso. We would always go back to Cézanne. There was no breaking this bond he had. And what he would say to me was, that bather's painting. Once Cézanne painted it, he said to anyone who was able to listen, there are no more rules. You can do anything you want in painting. So towards the end, that's what he was holding on to. There really were no rules. And very kindly, with the permission of his children, I got to go to his studio one more time after he died. And I just wanted to point out that all the little ones are the ones that were done in his last few months. That whatever the scale was, whatever the content was, he had reduced it all to this really manageable size, and there probably were at least 20 self-portraits. So his last months were spent really thinking about himself. And the other painting that was there was a painting of his real father, Mr. Brooks. And he had a painting of Sandra. And he would say to me, Sandra is in the studio with me every day. I talk to her all the time. She's my constant companion. So the anonymous woman really isn't. Yeah. It's always her.
I mean in form. Yeah. She's incredibly anonymous. You know what I mean? There's a sort of a swap in figures or in features that happens in the different ways he makes pictures.
But they're always her. Because I said to him, because he was a kind of a recluse and a little morose towards the end, and I said, would it cheer you up if we went and drew naked ladies like in the old days? And he said, I have done my last drawing from life. So at that point, in his old style, it was all up here, except for, yes, every book on Matisse, every book on Cézanne were open, and the paintings were there on the floor. Anywhere he went, he could be inspired by these people who he's still connected to. And I just love that we all still connect to him, because that's what art's all about. So that was my little story of Ron Kitaj.
Does anybody else have a question?
I know it's difficult. But I was wondering, most of those paintings, his wife was already dead when he painted those, no? Because for me, I think they have an incredible quality of presence. They're almost magical somehow. And I think that's part of so of a process, but it's so intimate that it's almost difficult not to feel it, but it's very difficult to express. And I think for me, they have a magical presence. What do you think about that?
Tom, Tom, can I toss that one to you?
Why me? well, you know, that's something that is part of a larger discussion, how every single viewer is affected individually by an artwork, and that, oh, sorry.
that's part of, I think, a different context discussion, how an artwork can affect every individual in a different way, and people see things in a painting depending on their degree of initiation into the world of art and what they know about the particular artist, etc. And we've all had experience of how our understanding of a work can shift dramatically. So I think I don't know what to say about that magical aspect. I mean, I would say I don't get that. I certainly would qualify it as being poetic.
Well, I also think there's a quality of trying to bring back what's lost.
Yeah.
You know, to evoke this person and bring her back and manifest her. And I understand what you're saying, Rebecca, because as he evokes her, it feels like she slips very quickly into an archetype. Not a specific person, an archetype. And that archetype is filling up this space. And I don't know if that goes to what you're saying about the idea of a magic presence, but it seems to me that maybe is a little bit of it. Well, an archetype is a more magical figure in that sense.
Well, I actually see it as there's something super tragic about it, because it's talking about holding on, it's just a desperate, there's an element of desperation to it that is almost difficult to tolerate.
But
for my response as a viewer to those.
No, I didn't mean to interrupt. No. I think part of it, though, is that the desperation is tempered by the actual lightness of touch and color. I mean, that's what's interesting to me, is that the color in these is not, maudlin gray and heavy. In fact,
right.
it's like if Matisse, got really depressed, you might have seen, he never seems to, but I mean, to have that sort of desperation mixing with this kind of joyous color actually has the complexity of and multiplicity, yeah, but in a pared down way for me.
Let's see, that's interesting. I don't see this as joyous color. I see it as frantic and hysterical. I don't get joy out of these paintings whatsoever.
Maybe luminous would be a better word.
Okay, well then we're moving into that magical department.
Well,
yeah.
Right.
There is a luminosity, but I think these things are shrieking hysterically. I don't see this color. I don't equate it. Although Kitaj might have wanted to identify himself color-wise with Matisse, obviously with that whole identification thing that was so important to him. But Matisse's color And I just had a chance to see a lot of Matisse's, luckily. The early, the late Matisse's, they are brilliant and luminous, and they are joyful because they are painted by an artist who was completely established in himself and settled in a way that we might say contained or projected or was the manifestation of real kind of wisdom, of knowing oneself completely. I don't get that here.
I see what you're saying.
So, yeah, Joshua.
In late 2005, I had the rare opportunity of going to his studio, and he showed us a large monograph that was going to be put out for his museum show. And he said, you know, he's like, I'm not going to be able to see this come to fruition. Like, he knew his passing was coming. And I feel like with some of these later paintings, he was, you know, intuitively also foreshadowing his death. You know, the return to his wife, her kind of being this angel in the studio, but also him kind of getting an interconnection of presence with him. And a lot of artists kind of foreshadow their own death as well.
Joe and I were talking about this right before we started speaking, and I think that you could, hindsight is 20/20, and I think artists in general dabble with the line. In terms of bringing lightness and darkness into the work, in terms of trying to articulate the human experience, you have to go there. And I think you never know when you're going to cross too, it is truly dangerous. And the sort of, it's like saying, how many times in art class have you heard, you have to risk the painting to get it. You have to, you know, you hear all these heroic things that are true and that are very difficult to do. To express human suffering, love, pain, madness, all of those things, you have to have an experience with them that's very direct. And you know, we look back at Van Gogh's Crows now and it seems obvious, but that's simply because we're looking through the lens of history. These paintings have a sort of darkness to them, but I think you could say that about some of the work from the 60s too. And we were looking at different examples of artists who killed themselves, the most recent being Mike Kelly in Los Angeles. And people, artists, unfortunately, that veil between sort of the edge and not being off the edge is very thin, and some people spend their whole life right up next to it, never going to the other side. It you just don't know, although you can see it looking back that a lot of these paintings are expressing something from that. I think there are also artists who've gone right up there, stayed there for a very long time, and then pulled back.
I mean,
go ahead.
I was just going to say, I kind of feel like any painting, the narrative overlay of suicide is just so strong that it seems irresistible to read. I mean, I can't myself not see it when I look at the work, but I think any painter, any artist who is dealing with life in any way is going to have the shadow side and the life side, and that it's simply what you look for. I mean, I was thinking, looking at a Vermeer's Girl with a Pearl Earring, you know, I mean, the feeling of time passing and fleeting, that painting is just as much about mortality as it's about beauty or a photographic moment to me, and it depends on how you look at it. So I think that all these paintings, I think all his work, whether you find value in the objects, I think that's one of the things about his work that's really characteristic all the way back. Sometimes it's through cleverness, sometimes it's through overt sentimentality, but I think the shadow side and the life side are always, you know, ringing around together in the same thing, which is what makes the work, I think, compelling, even if the painting might not be aesthetically pleasing to someone, one person or another.
You know, something that's occurred to me just while you were speaking and while this subject came up, I'm just going to try to contextualize it very quickly. The thing that has occurred to me, and when I was saying hysterical before, there's also a lot of violence in these paintings. And that violence you can identify even in the earlier Kitaj, in the brilliant pieces. And now we know that suicide is a violent act. And I do have to share with you that on my very first meeting with Kitaj, and on many subsequent visits to him, he did tell me that he didn't want to live anymore. You know, and at first I was stunned, and I tried in a very naive way, but I gave up very quickly of saying something like, well, or saying to myself anyway, because I didn't know how I could even communicate to him. We didn't know each other that well. Well, you know, all right, I can understand you feeling that way. We've all felt that way. You've been through a horrible situation here. Of course you may imagine that life, you don't want to live. But I do have to say that over the course of the several years that I got to know him, there wasn't one visit in which this did not come up either directly. We didn't discuss it in depth. I wasn't a person that Kitaj was going to confide in or have an in-depth discussion about his, but it would come out. Well, you know, as soon as Max is old enough, you know, I just want to make sure that he's okay. I do remember those conversations. At the same time, and I'm going to close with this, because Peter and I discussed this just about a week or two ago, this identification that we all know is so important to him, not only with artists, but with intellectuals, most of his Jewish intellectual heroes were suicides. There is a culture of suicides that, you know, and we do have to remember that Kitaj's roots are Viennese, and especially in the end of the 19th century, suicide was a fashionable kind of intellectual disposition. And I just want to, you know, you're right. Nobody knows these things for sure, but I can't help but consider this and, you know, share it with you regarding this topic.
Well, let's have one more question.
One thing that I was that I feel like everybody's been talking about, but nobody's really stated, is that, you know, it's a condition that painters are especially vulnerable to, but it's self-indulgence. This work reads of a lot of self-indulgence, which has, you know, included in that is a kind of like grandiosity, right, which is sort of deserving of ridicule, but then there's also this like intense vulnerability, which is very touching.
I think that's a great point, and something that I feel is important to the larger discussion about the direction of art right now, which is it has been mostly ridiculed. And we've all been at a poetry reading that is painfully embarrassing, or a performance art piece where you're just, your skin wants to leave your body. But for me, again, that risk, that calculated risk that he's taken to be direct and declarative, I see those as related. It is self-indulgent, it is narcissistic, it is potentially embarrassing. It's all of those things, and that is the condition of being a human being, to me. It's very, which is why you get reams of bad work, and then you get one in which people see it, and they see themselves, they see their experience, and not that you have to become the other, but to have a connection with another human being, you have to reach an appendage out. And that's what I feel like he's doing in these, because to make that gesture of sort of what I think matters, my experience, my individual story is important to tell, is ridiculous and embarrassing, but it's also fascinating to watch and interesting to engage with, and I think some of the greatest painters have done exactly that.
Yeah, I agree. I guess I also would add, I think he gets a certain amount of street cred for being a sort of more discreet artist earlier. I mean discreet in the sense of couching everything in super skill and all that. And it's a really different to come to a place of indulgence through a long road. For me, it's different. I guess I wouldn't want to mandate that for anybody else. But there's a line from a Death Cab for Cutie song that says, "Now we all know that the song that the lyrics to love songs, the cheesiest lyrics are true." Basically,
right. It's like that Depeche Mode song.
And you just don't want to think. You just don't want to go, "Yeah, that's true, man." But sometimes it's true, you know. And it's sort of. But I know what Tom's saying. Sometimes you're embarrassed for yourself for looking at the super indulgent statement. But yet, the vulnerability connects. So it's a real layered, complex experience of viewing the work. But to me, the complex layered experience is what it's all about in the end.
It's a denial of cleverness in a way that I think is important.
Agreed.
We are all not negotiating our way out of death or birth. Those are the things that we get. And no matter how clever we are, how many sort of complicated structures we can put our experiences in, those things are pretty simple.
Yeah.
And I think that he's sort of just right up next to him.
Pointing up to the bar on that. Yeah.
That seems like the perfect place to end. Thank you all very much.